I would like to take a moment to recognize them, that is the Browns, for their vision in helping to create and support this wonderful initiative. Jim and Noel, they're sitting here in the front row. Can we acknowledge them? Can you guys? Maybe I should tell a story here, maybe how we sort of met years ago. I got invited to breakfast by them, and we've been friends ever since. So I don't see them enough, but they're absolutely wonderful people. They really are. They're really great people. Social workers, and in particular, our school is committed to empowering people, leading organizations, and growing communities. We do this not alone, but in partnership with leaders from outside our profession, often working with interdisciplinary teams to impact complex challenges. The Browne Fellowship complements these efforts by providing students with an opportunity to explore the knowledge, values, and skills of social work and to establish a lifelong commitment to social economic justice. I will now turn over the program, as I promised, my comments will be very brief, to my colleague and friend, Mr. Keith Caldwell, the director of our BASW program. And once again, I want to thank all of you for joining us this afternoon. And once again, thanks to Browns for your generous support. This would not happen were it not for you. Thank you very much.
I promise I'll be brief as well. Thanks, Dean Davis. And thank you all for joining us to recognize the work of this inaugural cohort of Browne Leadership Fellows. As Dean Davis said, my name is Keith Caldwell. I'm the director of the bachelor's program. And I've also had the pleasure of coordinating the Browne Fellowship and working alongside nine wonderful students from across our university community, the true stars of our show today. To echo Dean Davis's remarks, I'd like to thank Jim and Noel for their support and vision in creating this kind of program that allows us to continue to disperse the values of social work across our university community and continue to help inspire and generate, in our own way, the next generation of civic and community leaders. I'd also like to thank our community partners. I've got a number of folks who are here today who joined us from the three cities, or three neighborhoods or communities that our students worked in over this past summer. And you'll get a chance to learn a lot more about the neighborhoods and the organizations who partnered with us and really allowed us the opportunity to be welcomed into their communities, to be welcomed into their organizations, and to serve alongside some really fantastic folks. As I said, my remarks would be brief as well. So, more importantly, I'd like to turn over the microphone to our stars of the hour, the 2013 Browne Fellows. We'll be joined by three groups of fellows. I like to call them teams, so Team Millvale, Team Manchester, and Team South Oakland, who are excited to share with you a bit about the communities where they serve, the organizations with which they partnered, and the work that they were able to carry out. So they'll just sort of go group by group, and I hope you enjoy their presentations as much as I have. So thanks so much. One for you and one for you.
Okay, so my name's Dominique Benzio. I'm a double major in psychology and urban studies with a minor in social work.
And my name is Kimaya Padgaonkar. I'm majoring in chemical engineering with minors in economics and bioengineering.
And our third team member, Shannon Reilly, is currently studying abroad in Jordan, but she will be making a digital appearance later in our presentation. So first, we want to just get you guys a little bit acquainted with Millvale, where we were this summer. A brief history of Millvale. It was founded in 1869 as a steel milling town in a valley, hence Millvale. It's 0.68 square miles, so it's pretty small, and it's right across from Lawrenceville on the Allegheny River, the 40th Street Bridge. If you cross over there, you're in Millvale. Millvale's population was booming in the early 90s and peaked in the 1950s, but as with many places in Pittsburgh, after the steel industry collapsed, so did Millvale's population. And it's most commonly heard of in the news because of the flooding of Gertie's Run that happened in 1972, 2004, and 2007 that contributed to their population and economic decline.
Since Shannon, Dominique, and I had not ever visited Millvale, we also wanted to get an idea of what their population was like. So it has been on the decrease. It's predominantly Caucasian. The median household income is a lot lower than the national average. And in 2000, actually 47% of residents rented their property.
So that gives you a really statistical, numerical view of Millvale, but part of our community assessment was to actually get into the community, talk to people, see what it was like from their point of view. So we conducted a series of interviews and attended some meetings, including the Millvale Borough Council, the Millvale Borough Development Corps, which led to some interviews with some key players in the community. North Hills Community Outreach is situated in Millvale, and we did an interview with them. Also with Brian Walovich, who is a key volunteer in Millvale, a councilman, and the president of the Millvale Community Library, which you'll hear about later. Denise Rudar, who is in the Millvale Borough Development Corps and co-chair of the Gardens of Millvale, which Kimaya will be talking about later. And Tom Walker, who's also in the MBDC.
Through our interviews and meetings in Millvale, we were able to analyze Millvale and its strengths. They're very resilient in the face of tragedies such as the flooding that has occurred in their town. They do have a growing willingness to learn and adapt. They have a very dedicated volunteer base. These are just a few of the people we talked to. We encountered so many other people, parts of the organizations, just people in the community that were really willing to help out and, you know, grow the community. They're very friendly to newcomers. We were just walking along the streets, just exploring town, and lots of people just came up, said, "Hi, what are your names? You know, who are you?" And then they're very optimistic about the future of Millvale. They really want to improve upon the community, get it growing, and we wanted to help them with that. So during the summer, Dominique, Shannon, and I were split up into different areas. Where I was, I worked with the Millvale Farm Stand as well as the Gardens of Millvale. So a little bit about the Farm Stand. It's part of the Clean, Safe, and Green Committee of the MBDC. It's in collaboration with the Pittsburgh Community Food Bank. So basically how it works is every week the food bank brings over food, and Millvale volunteers set up this farm stand so that people can purchase fresh produce. In a study done by an Emerson Hunger Fellow, actually, Millvale was categorized as a food desert. They don't exactly have a grocery store in town, so the Farm Stand is very beneficial. It runs about from May or June through November. And through my time there, I was able to help them set up and sell things and as well as clean up. A lot of people came to the Farm Stand. I was able to put out a survey where I just asked a few questions about, you know, the customers that were coming out there so that we could better improve the Farm Stand. Some of the results are here. A couple I'd like to highlight is that almost all of the customers were either first-timers or very experienced. So they're getting the word out there. People really want to use the Farm Stand, but at the same time, people continue to come back. They really like it. They really need it. So it's great, and it's helping the community. Another fact was that about 50% of the customers knew about urban farming and community gardening. So one of Millvale's goals is to collaborate the Gardens of Millvale, which I'll talk about in a second, with the Millvale Farm Stand. So basically the idea there is to grow their own food and sell it so that they will be a self-sustaining community in the future. So with the Gardens of Millvale, I worked there as well with Mandy and Denise. They're wonderful people. I did some organizational work, some, you know, de-weeding, as every gardener needs to do. I looked up some prices for compost bins because they're trying to be very eco-friendly. And I also put out a survey for the gardeners there. The way the Millvale Gardens work is that there are about 40 plots, and people are in the community are able to rent them out yearly. So they pay a very small fee, and they're able to grow whatever they want in the garden. The plots are right there. They're about that size. And they can actually hold a lot of plants and vegetables and flowers and whatever anyone wants to grow. And basically, the people that grow that, they tend to it themselves. And then they can take it home, use it for themselves. They can sell it. They can sell it at the farm stand. Or they can just share it with other neighbors. There's also a community herb spiral and a community greenhouse. Actually, back there, they're putting up a greenhouse that actually works so that it doesn't produce any waste. It uses all the water and it doesn't need any heat. So there's a lot of eco-friendly things going on in the gardens. Part of Millvale's goals are, like I said, to blend the garden with the farm stand. And for that, I helped the Gardens of Millvale put out a proposal to the Heinz Endowment Summer Youth Philanthropy Internship Program for their Great Greenhouses project. I'm happy to say that we are preliminarily accepted for a $10,000 grant towards the Millvale Gardens. And so hopefully that'll be in place soon and the Gardens of Millvale can further be successful.
So my placement in Millvale was with the Millvale Community Library, which also has a partnership with Three Rivers Waterkeeper to work on advocacy surrounding the Gertie's Run watershed. What I did with this part of the project in my first 2 weeks, I come from a background that has no experience with really environmental advocacy, so this was all new for me, which was fun. I was able to create a watershed assessment plan for them. By doing that, I researched a lot of the history of the watershed and the advocacy that had surrounded it in the past with their Joint Sewer Association, and conducted a SWOT analysis using both database research and interviews with people in the community. So I was able to give them this very comprehensive history of their watershed, where it's been and where it is now. I also created a plan for them to conduct a unified stream assessment, which is a way that normal volunteers can walk the watershed to assess different issues such as eroded banks, sewer outfalls, pollution sites, things like that. And a united subwatershed site reconnaissance, which is a way to identify places that are going to be hotspots for future innovation, implementation of green infrastructure, things like that. So the idea was that they could now take this plan, and whenever they have volunteers who are ready to do this work and they're ready to start some watershed advocacy, they can just look at it, it'll tell them what to do, it'll give them a template to put their information in, and they can have this wonderful document that will be able to spearhead that work. I was also able to find a lot of helpful links and resources for them with the watershed and potential partners like the Pennsylvania Interfaith Impact Network, Western Conservancy, Tree Vitalize, things like that. So with this Three Rivers watershed, I was able to create two deliverables, the assessment plan and also a poster that they can use for conferences, stressing the SWOT analysis, and that the next step that they need to take would be to establish a watershed association. Most of my work, though, was conducted with the Millvale Community Library. During the fellowship, I did a bunch of different things to try to get the library, which has been a 7-year plan and vision, up and running by August 18th, which was the grand opening. So my timing with the fellowship was perfect because they kind of needed that extra push. I was able to coordinate volunteers, which there were a ton of, help planning and executing summer programming and events such as their GED program, their children's arts and literacy programs, and their children's Millvale Junior Gardeners program. I organized and ran their first book sale, and a lot of my work was also just book sorting and cleaning, which needed to be done. I helped them recognize some of their donors through events and different ways to just show our appreciation, helped them fill out applications for the United Way and Pittsburgh Cares, and did just miscellaneous administrative tasks that needed to be done. But what I more want to focus on when we talk about the Millvale Community Library is their mission statement, more than a library, an agent for positive change. And I just really saw so many volunteers really living this mission statement when I was there. The library is the only library that's ever been in Millvale. The library before was at their high school, which closed in 1971. So people are really excited to be having a public library there where they can not only just check out books and other materials, but where they can have a meeting space to talk about community issues like the watershed, have GED classes, have children's programs, just have a place where they can be sitting in air conditioning some days in the summer. And it's really just been able to mobilize such a broad base of volunteers throughout the area, especially teenagers and young adult volunteers, that really will help improve the future of Millvale as they stay active with their community. So it was just a really great experience, and it really showed me the importance of volunteerism and continued civic action. So that was awesome. Okay, now for Shannon's part. So this is maybe gonna be a little bit weird, but hopefully you guys can all hear, and I'm just gonna play the audio that she sent in from Jordan.
Hi, my name's Shannon Reilly. I'm a proud member of Team Millvale and worked in the Millvale Borough creating a property database. And I'm currently in Amman, Jordan, So you will get to hear my lovely voice for this portion of the presentation. The role of the Millvale Borough in Millvale is the role of the municipal government. So pretty much everything that happens in Millvale, the borough has something to do with it. So from code enforcement to zoning violations to taxes to county records to the local government to coordinating with groups in town like the MBDC to help with townwide events, they do a lot. So my role in the borough was to create a database from scratch that would catalog the 1,922 properties in Millvale and the information on them. The reason they need a database is because before this database was created, they had the Allegheny County website to look up all of the properties and the information on them, which, I mean, the information is there on the website, but it's a lot of clicking. You can only look things up if you know their address directly or their lot and block number. So they had this website. All of it is information open to the public, as well as files within the borough on their own properties, and then code enforcement files and records within their office. And so the database was about kind of consolidating this information. I won't read all of these, but I just wanted to give you an idea of the information that's in this database. It's tons of stuff. The most important being who owns the property, especially for an area that has a lot of landlords. As well as if the property is vacant or occupied, the condition of the building, if they've paid their county taxes, as well as code violations, and then the other things that you see here. And there's all things that we hope to add in the future. So I'm biased, but I think that the new database is awesome because it's user-friendly, aka you can avoid the county website as much as possible. So it's the data is easy to find and sort. There's a filter feature. It's a consolidation of all the information in various places within the borough. And it's also a link between the info that the county has and the info that the borough has, giving them an idea of properties that might, you know, have fallen between the cracks or aren't identified by the people of Millvale as they are by the county that Millvale is in. It's also a bridge between the new computer system that they're installing, so this old information can kind of slide right into the new computer system that they have. It's great for management purposes. It gives you a handle on your property, which is really important for any kind of projects, such as the side yard sale project. So this is a small snapshot of some of the information that you can find on the database. This particular search is for the side yard sale project that Millvale is working to implement, and it's a program that allows people who are bordering an overgrown vacant lot to turn that lot into a part of their yard by allowing them to buy it from the government for a low cost, so that increases the value of their home as well as the quality of the neighborhood in general. So there are a few requirements for potential houses that they could buy. For example, the property being acquired has to be tax delinquent and publicly owned. And originally, you would have had to go through each property one by one to check. But now you can just filter, as you see in this little like black box, by those factors, such as if the like vacant, and that's what you see in that middle column, as well as to county taxes unpaid. And which you see a column in the column like 3 to the right of that. So it kind of gives you an idea of just how quickly that information can be acquired now.
Okay, so at the end of our presentation, we just really want to thank all of you for attending. We really want to give a special thank you to James and Noel Browne for their generous support to make this program possible. I know it was really a great experience for me, Camille, and Shannon, and I'm sure the other fellows as well. For Keith, kind of putting it all together, holding all the strings and all of his hard work on that. And for the citizens and our friends in Millvale, just for giving us so much rain and a great experience.
And if you guys want any further information, we'll be here for a little bit after the presentations as well. And these are also our email addresses, and we'd be happy to talk about our experience in the Browne Fellowship Program.
So now we're going to hand it off to Team Manchester.
Hi everyone, we're Team Manchester. My name is Mimi Frisch. I'm a junior majoring in Urban Studies and a BPhil in Global Health.
Hi, my name is Pietra Bruni. I'm a junior and I'm double majoring in Psychology and Film Studies.
Hi everyone, my name is Zach Segal and I'm a double major in History and Sociology and minoring in Philosophy.
Hi, my name is Nora Fergany. I'm majoring in Economics with a certificate in Public and Professional Writing.
So we're just going to start off with a brief overview, like Dominique and Kimaya did, about our community, and then kind of go into each of us, about what each of us did.
All right, here's a map of Manchester. It was founded in 1832, predominantly by English immigrants. And before it was even part of Allegheny City, it was its own jurisdiction. It had its own fire department, police department, and it's only about 2 miles from downtown Pittsburgh. For those of you unfamiliar with the North Shore, it's just past Hinesfield.
So the community is really great. It's very active and it's bordered right by Chateau Street, by Route 61. There's a lot of transportation. We have all of the bus services as well as the T, so there's a lot of ways to access community, as well as there's a pretty active pedestrian population as well that walks around, and there's a good amount of parking on the streets and everything as well.
So just to give you guys kind of like a snapshot of what Manchester's like if you've never visited, it's primarily residential. It's really beautiful. Like, we went down one day and just walked around, and they have these huge Victorian houses, and it's really just a gorgeous area. So there's a lot of new development in Columbus Square. The current population of Manchester is a little over 2,000. It has had a large population decrease since 2000, and it's predominantly an African-American community with 10% Caucasian. It has a lot of a younger population, which is really great. That's like very encouraging for, you know, further development over time. And the information at this time, information suggested, but after actually getting experience, I think we can all agree that there's a very, very strong sense of community. So this is an example of one of the beautiful houses. And again, the new development in Columbus Square, which is really exciting.
The Manchester community is really based upon places of worship. So I think there's about 9 churches, and it's a pretty small radius for that that number of churches. The Bidwell Church is one of the biggest organizations in Manchester. It was started by Reverend Browne, who was the first African-American football player at Pitt. There's also lots of social and community organizations. One of the ones we worked at, the Manchester Citizens Corporation, they help redevelop the housing, the blighted housing in the area. There's also the Manchester Area Charter School, MAX, and the Manchester Elementary School. They're also really important. They help develop the strong sense of community that Manchester has.
So we really all observe that there is a very strong sense of community within it, especially all of the citizens are really active in the neighborhoods, people out all the time, and some of these signs really show that people are taking an active part in protecting and preserving their community. And as Nora said, there are a lot of places of worship as well, and schools and youth development centers, and it's really a very active community.
These are a list of the organizations that we worked with in Manchester. There's the Pittsburgh Community Telephone Corporation. They run a Pittsburgh television channel. There were the summer program at MAX and the MYDC. They work with the PCTV. They work on television programs. The North Shore Community Alliance. They're a resource for families in crisis in Manchester. The Manchester Youth Development Center. They're a place for kids to go after school and stay there, stay off the streets, be productive. The St. Vincent de Paul Society, PD work there. They're a prominent Catholic church in Manchester. The Manchester Citizens Corporation, me and Zach work there. They work with the housing in Manchester.
This is just a very brief overview of the Manchester Citizens Corporation, where Nora and I worked. For instance, they built 48 townhomes over on Pennsylvania Ave. And if you come in to the neighborhood from the California Kirkbride neighborhood, you'll see all the development going on at Columbus Square, and that's all part of the Manchester Citizens Corporation's work. Some of the stuff that we did over this summer was learning to work with Adobe Dreamweaver software, and Nora and I had absolutely no experience with web design at all, but they gave us pretty much full access to kind of like a sandbox to learn what worked and what didn't when trying to make a website. We went out and made a list of community street captains, and these were people on each street who the MCC could contact to disseminate new neighborhood information much easier than before. And our main project was on July 9th, we had a business networking event, and we have some pictures of that coming, but we had Councilman Lavelle, who services the district, he was there. We had a couple banks, including Fifth Third Bank, First Niagara. There's Carol Washington of the North Shore Community Alliance, Breda Bay of Fifth Third Bank. That's the back of Councilman Lavelle, for those of you who recognize him. And then there's Nora and I. The reason the project was such a great opportunity is we had never had the chance to really spearhead something on our own. The MCC gave us their full support in inviting everyone, setting up the food, making name cards, pretty much just spearheading something that we'd never done before.
So I had the unique opportunity of being able to work at both Manchester Academics Charter School as well as Manchester Youth Development Center and Pittsburgh Community Television Station, so lots of acronyms there. So my projects kind of incorporated the work for both of those and being a liaison between all three organizations as well as working individually with each of them. So at MAX and MYDC, I got a lot of time to kind of hang out with all the kids. It was a great opportunity to really get into the neighborhood and see how the community operated and how different it was from other neighborhoods and how a really unique community it is. For the majority of the time, I spent a lot of time with the second grade class and really got a chance to work with them as well as a lot of the teachers. MYDC has a unique opportunity where during the summer they have a summer camp that's also primarily giving extracurricular and curricular support to students during the summer to continue their learning. So I worked with them and helping them out as well as helping to develop fundraising materials for MYDC to help continue sort of connecting the students with MYDC to make kind of full and great opportunities for them. As well as I did some other little unique projects with gardening for the fifth graders and helping to kind of bring them outside. I found out that they love to garden, so we did some stuff just simply talking about nutrition and healthy eating and things like that with the small vegetable garden, as well as just getting them out. They found out they love to weed. So we did lots of weeding of the flower boxes, which was a lot of fun as well. Pittsburgh Community Television Station is a public access station, and they had this great opportunity where they invited a lot of students from MYDC to come over and, in essence, produce a television show that would then be aired on TV. So I worked a lot with this group of seventh graders to help them develop what they wanted to talk about, which in essence ended up being kind of 10 top reasons you should come to MYDC. And so they kind of all got to write their scripts and produce that and then learn how to film it and edit it as well. And in addition to that, I kind of had to learn how to do the technical assistance for show production, which was a great opportunity considering I had no experience in that prior. And so with that, I learned a lot about the importance of public access television and how important it is to have the free speech and that ability for any residents to really come in and speak about what they view to be important for them and have that on air. And so I learned a lot about things that you might not necessarily learn in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette or public air stations. So that was a really great opportunity as well, just a little bit to learn more about the community. And finally, this is the group of second graders that ended up being on the fundraising poster. And overall, I learned a ton. It was a really great opportunity just to truly spend time in the community, but also kind of have impacts in little ways as well.
Hi, so again, I'm Pietra Bruni. I had the opportunity to work with the Society of St. Vincent de Paul. For those of you that aren't familiar with the society, they do just so much. It's absolutely ridiculous. I worked in their headquarters in Manchester, which is a great outreach place for the community, and had a food pantry. But at the same time, in my home of the South Hills, I actually volunteered with the society in high school. So it was especially awesome for me to be able to kind of continue that into my college career. So my primary responsibilities were researching and presenting a comparison of different multimedia efforts completed by different St. Vincent de Paul organizations across the United States. So we really kind of put it bluntly, one to like up our game and, you know, just revamp the website and do a lot of more outreach. So I kind of got to do a lot of research, which was a really great experience and kind of taught me a lot about how to reach out to the community and for people who may not be familiar with the society. I also volunteered at the weekly food pantry, weighing, packing, and restocking the food. This was personally my favorite part. It was very hands-on, and it was really great just to kind of interact with people in the community. It also taught me a lot, just honestly, about food pantries and the way they work. I know I talked with Keith a lot because I had some questions with the way food was divvied out, and I felt like I had a chance to kind of express my opinions, and my voice was actually heard, which was super great experience. Also, I interviewed various St. Vincent de Paul patrons about their personal experiences and how the society has helped improve their quality of living. That is currently in the process of being put together for a promotional video, which will be put on the St. Vincent de Paul website and used just so those who might not actually be able to interact with the patrons that go to the food pantry can hear about the work the society does. So I love photos. So here's a photo of the food pantry. It's a great experience because, like, you see there's shopping carts and people kind of have that grocery store feel. They can go through and choose like different sorts of produce, different canned goods, and things like that. That's where I stood with the scale. It's very fun. So I'd say the number one thing about St. Vincent de Paul is they really work on fostering a strong community. Even though a lot of the employees that work at the society and more of the clerical areas were from the South Hills and different parts of Pittsburgh, I saw the same people every week coming in. And this is Mr. Benny, Mr. Washington, and Mr. Max, and they're all like super cool and really nice. And they were there every week and gave me some crap sometimes when I would give people chicken instead of turkey, but they kept me in line, and it was really, really fun, and they definitely became my buddies. So one experience I did have, I got to go to Michael's Place, which is run by the Society of St. Vincent de Paul. It is a voluntary residential program for men who have just left the prison system or have come out of rehab for drugs and alcohol, and they live here independently and are provided with jobs, education, development of life skills, and emotional and mental support. I actually went here on my own because the person was supposed to accompany me and just kind of had a conflict of errors, and I actually went with one of my friends, and we had such a good time. Like, all the guys were super nice. One of the gentlemen had just gotten a job that day. He was really excited, and again, I just am really thankful for the experiences to kind of really interact with the community and get to know people on a more personal level. So yeah, oh, it's also non-sectarian, which is like really cool. So people of all faiths and religious denominations are encouraged to come, and there's no discrimination. So again, we just would really, really, really like to thank Mr. and Mrs. Brown, obviously Pitt, and everyone for the experience that we all had in Manchester. We all had totally different experiences, but I think we all learned a lot, and it was a really great summer.
All right, hello everybody. We are Team South Oakland. My name is Samantha Levinson. I am a junior. I major in French and economics with minors in English literature and history, and I'm pursuing the Women's Studies certificate as well as the Western European Studies certificate. So a lot. Do you want to click to the...
Oh, sorry.
No, I like the quote.
I was sorting out my mic, so... So my name is Zeba Ahmed. I'm majoring in Japanese and sociology with a minor in Korean and an Asian Studies certificate, and I'm a senior. We were placed with Community South Oakland, and you will get to see a lot about it.
All right, so I'm going to lead us off by just explaining how this presentation is going to work. Zeba is going to lead us through an understanding of the location, history, and the economic and social characteristics of South Oakland. And then we're going to talk about community human services, which is where we had the pleasure to be placed for the summer. I'm going to talk a little bit about the different functions that CHS actually has within the community. We're going to talk about how all of that information worked together for us to figure out what we wanted to do in the community. We're going to talk about that. We're going to have a little bit of a multimedia thing going on, and then we're going to reflect on our experiences.
Okay, so South Oakland is this area that's like in white right here. It's actually not, like, most college students think that South Oakland includes what is normally considered, what's technically considered Central Oakland, like below 5th below Forbes. It's actually below Boulevard of the Allies, isn't the majority of South Oakland. South Oakland is split into two parts, the west side, which identifies with the the Oak Cliff Housing Club, and the east side, which identifies with the South Oakland Neighborhood Group. So South Oakland was settled by Europeans in the 1700s. There was the Eliza furnaces, which made steel, and they were located along the river, which meant that a lot of steel workers lived there in the 1800s and the 1900s. In 1915, the Elizabeth McGee Steel McGee Hospital was built, and it was later renamed to what we all know as the McGee Women's Hospital of UPMC. There used to be 4 to 5 churches in South Oakland, but now there's only just one, which is St. Regis on Parkview Avenue. Most people either attend that church or other churches located elsewhere in South Oakland. In terms of the economic and social characteristics of South Oakland, the housing stock is very poor. A lot of houses are worth less than $10,000. A lot of it's a result of people being impoverished, and they're unable to take care of large projects, as you can see in this picture here, where the stairs are kind of rickety and really crooked. But on the other hand, this house also had this like really nice wired bird, which means they have attention to detail and they care about their property, but they might not be able to take care of the large maintenance issues. There's also very few businesses in South Oakland. There's a laundromat that recently opened, but there's no grocery stores. So people who go grocery shopping have to go far away as Shadyside to get their groceries. And also very little parking, where there's like competition over like permit parking and free parking, and like the number of people like trying to like find parking spots as close to where they live and where they work as possible. The majority of a large portion of the population is 20 to 24 year olds, which is like college age students, and there's been a significant decrease in the number of family households, and a significant increase in the number of people living in each household, and the number of renters. As you can see from the statistics, which we got from census data and city data, you can see that there's been a significant increase in the number of student renters in South Oakland and a decrease in the number of families. We were placed with Community Human Services, which is a service agency in South Oakland, and Samantha's going to tell you a little bit more about that.
All right, thank you. So Community Human Services has many branches, but the first location and the primary location is located at 374 Lawn Street in South Oakland. It is so far into South Oakland that you're about 8 minutes away from the south side if you decide to walk on your lunch break. So there are many different resources available at the South Oakland office of CHS. One of them is the food pantry, which we both spend a lot of time in. I'll get to that a little bit later, but that offers food to people no matter where you're from. It's not based in a zip code. If you can get there, we will serve you, is the way it works. There's also housing for people with different kind of like mental health issues. We also provide supported housing, which means you can stay in your own home, but if you need somebody to come by and ask you like, hey, have you paid your bills this month? We have that. We grow very fond of CHS, which is why the we is being used. There's also a non-traditional emergency shelter housing, which means that families can stay together. It preserves more of a family perspective on people who, you know, might be experiencing homelessness, as opposed to the women go here, the men go here, you have to be at a certain time, you have to leave here, you know, it's a different structure. We also had a summer camp this past summer, which actually hadn't existed for a couple years back because of issues with funding. So that was pretty exciting, seeing all these little children run around. It was also a little terrifying to me, but it was great to have that. It was great to have that back, and really suggesting the youth in the community that exists and how we can better serve all these different demographics, which was one of the questions that we definitely had to think through.
So we spent a lot of time in the food pantry. Volunteers were involved 3 days a week on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Wednesday was the day we got food from the food truck, and then Thursday and Friday we distributed the food to our customers.
Right, yeah, I got very nicely sculpted arms from carrying all that food off of that truck, I will tell you that. But the motto of our food pantry, similar to what Manchester was talking about, was that we're not going to package it all up and be like, all right, how many people in your household? Okay, take 4 bags of food. It's the idea that it's a supermarket. It's the idea that there's respect in this exercise and that we don't want these people to feel any worse coming here. So you go through and you're like, all right, would you like pork and beans or vegetarian beans? Do you want to split it up? You know, like I got very good at having those conversations, but it's about treating people with respect and, you know, making friends in the neighborhood, I guess, through this process and trying to get people to take acorn squash when you have that donated by Plant a Plate and no one knows what an acorn squash is. So it was a lot of fun from that point of view and just helping people in that way. Right, so the community assessment, which was the census data as well as the first couple weeks actually in community, we were trying to figure out what do we want to do with our time here? What can we leave in this community that can have an impact even when we ourselves are gone? So there are a lot of themes that are up here that we just kind of figured out. You know, Zeba alluded to most of them. But what we really saw is that we have these two clear demographics. You have the older residents who have been here for 40 years maybe, and their parents built the house or their grandparents built a house, and they don't like what they've seen, the change in their neighborhood. And then you have the students who are very transient in nature and don't really have much of an interest in committing to South Oakland as a neighborhood. And so what we wanted to do was figure out how we take these two kind of juxtaposed groups and how do we bring them together to craft a forward-thinking community, a forward-thinking identity, a forward-thinking perspective on how we can come together and produce something, construct something here. And kind of revitalize and bring pride to the community for everybody. So what that meant is we made a documentary, which involved 22 one-on-one interviews that we conducted from people from all different types of backgrounds, people who've been here for very little amount of time, to people whose grandfather built the house and he's been here and his whole family has died, but he is still here. And we just wanted to see what everyone thought about. And it wasn't a matter of coming up with a prescriptive, this is how South Oakland should be. But the idea that identity is not something that we craft, but something that we just have to facilitate. We facilitate the dialogue. So we got these people to talk to each other when they really wouldn't ever have talked to each other by talking to us as the intermediary. So these are the major topics that actually presented themselves. And these are the major topics that are in the documentary, which we had. We had our first viewing party for this past Wednesday. You might have seen our mention in the Post-Gazette. But what we're going to show is the trailer, because the actual documentary is 33 minutes. So we're going to show you a brief trailer for it, hypothetically.
Wait, where'd it go? Sorry, having technical difficulties.
We did practice this. But yeah, landlords, housing, the role of the university, which was very contentious, the past versus present South Oakland, the benefits of living in the neighborhood, and also the things that you wish you could kind of change about your neighborhood, or at least better about it.
Wait, I know what's wrong. Yeah.
Is that up and running?
Yes.
No.
Well, now we're there.
Samantha, good job filling time.
Yeah, I'm very good at that.
Okay. Hi, I'm Dominique Benzio, and I am South Oakland.
Hello, my name is Adam Dove, and I am South Oakland.
I'm Sharon McHenry, I am South Oakland.
Ezekiel Grace, I am South Oakland.
Darren McHenry, I am South Oakland.
I'm Martin, and I am South Oakland.
Michelle, Dave.
We are South Oakland.
My name is Jesse Anderson. I am South Oakland.
Hi, my name is Liz Gray, and I'm South Oakland.
But what does it mean to be South Oakland? This is the question we posed to 22 South Oakland residents, ranging in age, race, socioeconomic class, and opinion, most of all. We asked them why they stay here and what they want to see in their neighborhood. And what we were really asking is, what is the South Oakland identity? This documentary focuses on the major themes present in all 22 interviews. Questions of landlords and housing, the role of the university in South Oakland, as well as broader questions like, what do you love about your neighborhood? Each response went into creating a more holistic understanding of how different groups can coexist in South Oakland. The hope being that by forcing a dialogue between different demographic groups on the screen, we may open up the discourse in the neighborhood, creating a community with ties forged not solely amongst those who agree, but amongst all who call this neighborhood home.
Thank you. So that is obviously the trailer for the larger documentary, which will probably be distributed in multiple ways, coming to a theater near you soon. I guess I'm going to start my reflection a little bit on just what the experience meant to me. And I have to say that when I was thinking about this, I was like, okay, don't sound cliche, Samantha, but whatever, if it works, it works. And I think that what we learned through all of our experiences was that I didn't grow up with a community, really. I grew up in a very traditional white suburb in Maryland outside of D.C., and I wasn't used to people knowing me when I walked down the street, and I wasn't really comfortable when they did. But going into South Oakland, at first, everyone knew we were there, that we didn't belong there. You know, we went into CHS the first day, and the only reason we made friends is that I made us do karaoke. And by making a fool of yourself, you succeed in making friends. But what we found is the more we went there, the more people got to know us, and we couldn't even talk about anything serious. You just have to talk with people. And when we did our interviews, that was something that I kind of knew, and you kind of know in the back of your head, but when you see it, it means something. It's that people just need you to ask questions. You know, you just need to ask them, you know, how's your day going? You know, what do you like it about? What do you like about living here? What do you want to change? And they're very broad, and you could get the, I don't know, and we did get that. But a lot of the cases, we got people, you know, thinking about that and being honest with us, and by extension, being honest with themselves. And after we showed the documentary, people started talking about it, which, like, was so exciting. Because it meant that it worked, you know, and it meant that people started talking to each other. And I guess that's the most important thing, and I think we all forget that. I know when we went back for our documentary, some people had forgotten we were doing a documentary. Even people who, like, we interviewed. But that's okay, because they remembered my name, which is totally more important. And, well, no, you know what I mean. But it's about, like, community and identity are these things I think we talk about a lot in the classroom, but knowing what that means when you see it and you feel it is completely different. And I mean, that was the biggest thing for me. And that's, like, what I took away from this experience and why I still like to go and walk around down there when I have time.
So what I took away is that there was a lot of, you know, discrepancy between the way that people saw students. There were people who loved the students. They were like, they're energetic, they're fun, they say hi to me, they're really nice. And then there's other people who said, like, these students always have really horrible parties on the weekend. I've had to, like, call the cops on them. They're so noisy, they make a mess, they leave their trash everywhere. So there's a lot of different opinions about that, which I got to see. And it was interesting because I always thought that everyone hates students. But there's also, like, different kinds of students, you know, the good ones and the not-so-good ones. I spent a lot of time on both sides of Bates in the two different South Oakland communities, and I got to see that in addition to CHS, which is where we spend a lot of our time, the Fraser Fieldhouse, which is, like, basically kind of like a small, like, concrete block building with a softball field and, like, a playground next to it, in a garden next to it, that was, like, a really good area for the South Oakland neighborhood group to gather and for a lot of people, like, the kids to play and for people to hold barbecues and stuff. Like, they recently had their South Oakland Community Day over there, which was a great success from what I heard. So I can see, like, a lot of potential for community to develop in both places. I also learned a lot about Pittsburgh's resources and networks. Through CHS and through trying to find who to interview and, like, how to contact them, we got to see a lot of the relationships between different organizations that I didn't know about before. Based on my experience, I've actually decided to continue working with nonprofits in the future, and I hope to study their social influence, possibly in Japan, since I am a Japanese major. I spent a lot of time studying Japanese, so. Thank you very much.
Yeah, we just want to say thank you to everybody, especially the two of you.
Mute your mic, if you could. So thanks, everybody, for coming out today and hearing the wonderful work that these students carried out over the past year. What we really wanted to do was bring them through an experience of really understanding and appreciating community and their ability to impact that community, to grow, to strengthen and develop, and also, as we saw, to become a part of them as well. So I think we have a minute or two just for one or two questions, if anybody has one. And we can make all of them come up and stand in front of you all as a group. Come on up, guys. Did anybody have a question or a comment they'd like to share with the fellows or anything they'd like to hear a little bit more about? Yeah.
I don't need that. So I have the luxury of working.
Or
passionate women blew the socks off our neighborhood and were able to single-handedly sort of undo a little bit of the parties to say young people are really incredible assets to our community, and we're really grateful that Keith allowed us to participate in this. So kudos to all of you. You're amazing people doing world-changing work, and I can't wait to see what you do next year.
Thanks.
Hi, you saw the back of my head. My name is Carol Washington on the film. No, I had the pleasure of working with the Manchester team, and what they did not tell you was that we had a cultural competency class in the beginning, because we did not want the students. Normally, students of social work kind of think they know what to expect from a community. These were majors that would not normally come into our community and our territory and do business with our families and our children. So we gave them an icebreaker. It was the boot camp of cultural competency. But these students are so dedicated. I just wish I had an ounce of them in me 20 years ago. I might have turned out to be a Japanese economic with a sidebar of social work. Amazing. It's an amazing program. I pray that it keeps going, but leaders like myself and the Manchester leaders of the community truly appreciate your journey, and thank you for allowing us to share that with you.
Anybody else? Well, thanks again for coming out, and let's give a round of applause one more time to our wonderful fellows for accepting applications for the 2014 fellows. So there are brochures in the back. Please distribute them far and wide. And thanks again.